stupid-ass seagulls!"
exclaimed an aggravated beachgoer, aggressively wiping off some seagull crap from their shoulder. I begin to laugh, recalling times that I have felt personally attacked by a seagull, and how I have created a pretty unkind narrative towards those stupid seagulls. Their reputation is not a true representation of what they provide to marine ecosystems, but rather is derived from a accumulation of troubling human interactions. Sadly, many of our cultural views of the marine environment in the West are derived from biased experiences, and lack thereof, with the ocean and its inhabitants, causing a broad disconnect between people and the marine environment, especially among those with less access to it. When humans encounter life forms that are unfamiliar or strange to us, our instinct is often to distance ourselves from them, says Serena Imbler in her essay, "Are You Really So Different from the Blue Sea Blob?" We gawk at how the blueprint of their body veers from our own. Sometimes they confuse or repulse us.
The disconnect that Imbler is speaking of is directly related to our ill will towards a seagull, for example. When we begin to disgrace and separate ourselves from the important pieces of the marine environment, we begin to separate ourselves from one of the most important connections to nature that we have, our connection to the ocean.
I was an English major in college. I went to Vassar College and was particularly interested in early 19th century U.S. literature. I think there's been an evolution from 19th century tendencies to imagine the ocean as this like big undifferentiated space that can absorb anything, to more recent and more nuanced relationships to the marine environment and literature that are defined in more like intimate human scaled terms, because we now have such a better understanding of the degree to which humans impact oceanic environments.
Towards thee I roll, thou all-destroying but unconquering whale. To the last I grapple with thee. From hell's heart I stab at thee. For hate's sake I spit my last breath at thee. Herman Melville's Moby Dick exemplifies 19th century views of the ocean. It contributes to inaccurate narratives of marine life's resentment towards humans, and that the ocean is far too infinite for us to negatively affect it. Both of these ideas have been proven false.
So if it is known that these narratives are unsubstantiated, where do we go from here? Why is there still a disconnect between humanity and the marine environment? With the increasingly harmful effects of human-caused climate change, it is essential that people rebuild their relationships with the marine environment. But how does this happen? The hope is that proper means of communication can be a key factor.
Storytelling basics are kind of more hardwired into our psyches. Just there are thousands of years of history of how stories are told and what makes a good story. He was a great storyteller. He was a best-selling author. His logs of his scientific travels and geographic exploration were bestsellers. And he was an artist, and he drew and painted and illustrated his adventures. So there was no wall between being a scientist and being a geographer and being a storyteller and being an artist. Science communications person can break through those walls.
When discussing using art to communicate science with Hatfield Marine Science Center director Bob Cowan, he talked about the new Gladys Valley Marine Studies building, mentioning that it helps transform the concept of where art and science can meet and really learn from each other and communicate for each other. How can these science communication skills be used to tap into people's emotional connection to the ocean?
I have connection to the ocean since I was a child. Where I live is sand, desert, but there is a part of the ocean, but I was on that side more.
How can this connection translate to empathy and nurture towards the marine environment during its time of need amidst the climate crisis?
One of the things I love about literature and art is that these are mediums that do not prescribe what we should think about a thing. They are mediums that invite us to think about a thing.
But I think having deeper stories that are longer in length and that get people in a room together and make an event are a compelling way. So you might only reach 50 people or 100 people at live screenings, but it could equal tens of thousands or hundreds or millions of views of something really short on the web, because getting somebody to think about something for an hour or an hour and a half creates an emotional kind of journey for that person. And that's much more likely to to reach them in such a way that they might take an action about an environmental issue.
I want to make an impact on something, like on the world. Good impact, not a bad impact.
Yes.
Yeah.
I hope so.
Yeah. No. But I was trying to find a way. Like, climate change was an interesting subject for me since I was in high school. I think taking an aspect of that on ocean, mainly ocean acidification, that would really help me and help me in the future to make the different I want to see in the world.
It's inspiring to see young scientists and students who aren't mourning the loss of things that aren't here because they weren't there to witness the baseline before it shifted, and they're just ready to push up their sleeves and do something about it.
The growing impact that young people are having on the direction of science is powerful. They are no longer bound by strict scientific vernacular and are pushing the bounds of the emotional connection scientists are allowed to portray in their work. Well, I would like to hold my little hand. Dennis Davis, a native Shishmaref Alaskan photographer, uses his images to display the current state of his home and to spread awareness about the power and beauty that it holds. He sums up the reality of Earth's current human-altered climate and how artists can communicate the science through emotional visuals. Many questions of how to further the effects science communication has on people's willingness to evoke change are still unanswered. But one thing that is certain is the importance that all forms of science communication have in spreading awareness and empowering people to make positive change in marine environments. Cynicism is just being lazy, said OSU alum and former National Geographic editor and chief Chris Johns, highlighting the need for people to be hopeful and resilient. Two things that there cannot be a shortage of moving forward. The water, it cures everything. I would like to reach out my hand. Only sail, only tell you to run. All the way. Mumbai, say, Mumbai, yeah.